to judge the living and the dead. All eyes will look on your glorious face, shining like the sun. Who is like you, God?
Of Calvary, you, the perfect Holy One, crushed your Son, who drank the bitter cup reserved for me. Your blood has washed away my sin, Jesus. Thank you, the Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Once your enemy, now seated at your table, Jesus, thank you.
There is no one like our God. Let's stand as we sing to him this morning. One, two, three, four.
Matchless in your glory.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome today. What a beautiful, beautiful day that we get to be here with one another. And I do want to say happy Mother's Day to all of our moms. And again, what a blessing God has given to humanity, to his creation, that we are gifted with moms. Cannot say enough the influence of a mother in the life of their kids. And so all of our moms today, thank you for being you and for being faithful in the role God's given to you. And we hope that today is a major day. There we go. On our way out today, we do have a gift for all of our moms. So please, moms, when you file out, grab one. And we just want to say that we love you and we're grateful for you. And again, we hope today's an encouragement to you. A couple announcements, reminders for us. Today is the last day. If you are interested in ordering a t-shirt or a sweatshirt with this year's theme on it, we have a display in the back, and so encourage you, if you're interested in doing that, you can fill that out today, get your order placed, and we'll get that ready to go this week, and then hopefully in a couple weeks we'll get those here, and we're excited for that time. Elders, we've got a meeting tomorrow night, and so church, please be praying for your elders as we seek the Lord and want to be diligent, faithful, godly shepherds, and we're meeting tomorrow night. And then on Tuesday night, the 14th, we're going to be having a night of prayer here at church. And again, this is not 4 to 8 that you're here for 4 hours. The point of this time is in that window, I encourage you, I invite you, come as an individual, as a family, to spend time in prayer. We're going to have 4 different stations set up with different prayer emphases, and just have kind of a guided opportunity for you to spend time diligently seeking the Lord in different areas. And so I want to give the encouragement, whether it's you come straight from work, whether you go home and eat dinner and come afterwards, make time again to be here to pray. And I don't want this to come across manipulative or I'm making you feel guilty when I say this. But I do want to give you the encouragement, the amount of time that we pray and our commitment to prayer, I think is a great reflection of how much we recognize our need for God. Do we realize how much we need God? And if we know that, we should seek him diligently, consistently, deeply in prayer. So I want to invite you to be here Tuesday night, and I trust God's going to bless that time, and that'll be a great encouragement for each of us. On Saturday night this week, we have a young adult game night here at the church, and so it's from 6:30 to 9 o'clock. Like I said, you can talk to Thomas and Jessica, Bill and Kayleen, or the Smiths, Casey and Christina about that, but that's going to be a wonderful time, so I encourage you, if you're outside of high school and up into that young adult age range, be here and make connection, build relationship, and that's going to be a great time. Next Sunday, all of our ladies encourage you to stick around afterwards. We're going to have a baby shower for Brenna Veldman, and so encourage you to be here just to bless her and encourage her, and again, excited to be able to again be able to celebrate with her for that. All right, I want to invite you, would you please stand with me as we read our passage for call to worship? We're in Romans chapter 5, and we're going to look at verses 6 through 8. Romans 5, starting in verse 6, this is the word of God. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Would you pray with me? God, as we get ready to continue our service, Lord, as we get ready to sing and worship and delight in you, we're reminded, even as we just read in Romans, of the love that you've demonstrated for us. Not because we earned it or deserved it, but because we are sinners. And in spite of that, you did what was necessary to pay the price for our sins. And so God, thank you for sending your son Jesus to pay that price. And Jesus, thank you for being willing to come and live a perfect life and die an undeserved death for the sake of redeeming your people. Thank you for that blessing. Thank you for our time today. I pray for all of our moms. Thank you for the great gift that they are and the encouragement that they are to so many, many people. We pray that today would bring glory to you and you would center our hearts and our minds on you today and that we would be made more and more into the likeness of your Son, Jesus. It's in Jesus' name that we do pray.
Since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more now that we are reconciled shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation.
To doubt. Why would I dwell in fear when all I have known is grace? My future in Christ is clear. My sins have been paid in full. There's no condemnation here. I live in the good of this. My Father has brought me near. I'm leaving my fears behind.
Christ the sure and steady anchor in the fury. fast to the anchor, it shall never be removed. Christ the shore and steady anchor, while the tempest rages on, when temptation claims the battle.
Trials of life, in the seasons of temptation, in the adversity that we face, we thank you that we have this unmovable rock, this steady anchor, the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, who lived the life that we could never live and died that cruel death that we all deserve to die. Father, as we dig deeply into your word this morning, I pray that your spirit would be our teacher, that he would be our instructor, move us to action, to submission, to obedience, all for the great name's sake of Jesus Christ. For it's in his name we pray. Amen. I invite you to open your Bibles this morning to Psalm chapter 119. And if you have a Bible similar to mine, you will see that probably on your page, you will see chapter 120 looming large. And you know what that means. That means we're almost done with this series, so we are on the home stretch. This morning, I would like to have you think back to the day that you became a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, for some of you, you will have to stretch your memory banks back 30, 40, 50, 60, or even more years. But for others of you who are newer in the faith, this exercise will be much, much easier. Just a few questions. When you became a Christian, did you realize what you were signing up for? When you signed on the dotted line, did you realize what you were getting into? Did you realize that you, when you became a Christian, were actually enlisting in God's army? That you would be a part of God's kingdom program, If someone asked you what the normal Christian life involved, exactly what would you tell them? Would you tell them, as many people do today, that the Christian life is a life that involves health, wealth, and prosperity? I'm referring to the damnable prosperity gospel, which is absolute nonsense. Or would you tell them that the Christian journey is simply a life of ease? Would you tell them that the Christian journey is free from temptation, free from adversity, or free from persecution? Now, if you've been a Christian for any amount of time, you will quickly realize that the Christian life is indeed a blessing. But it is also a battle. The Christian life, you will freely admit, is a life that is very fulfilling, but sometimes it can be very frustrating. The Christian life is also one where we live lives of peace, but sometimes the Christian life can be very perplexing. The title of the message this morning is The Normal Christian Life. And I think if we're all honest, the Christian life is anything but normal. Amen? What are some common themes that we can expect as normal as a part of our Christian journeys together? The psalmist helps us to unpack the answer to this very important question. I want to invite you to stand as we continue our study in Psalm chapter 119, and we'll begin our reading of God's word in verse 153. This is the word of the living and the true God. The psalmist writes, "Look on my affliction and deliver me, for I do not forget your law. Plead my cause and redeem me. Give me life according to your promise. Salvation is far from the wicked, for they do not seek your statutes. Great is your mercy, O Lord. Give me life according to your rules. Many are my persecutors and my adversaries, but I do not swerve from your testimonies. I look at the faithless with disgust because they do not keep your commands. Consider how I love your precepts. Give me life according to your steadfast love. The sum of your word is truth, and every one of your righteous rules endures forever." May God bless the reading of his word. You may be seated. This morning I have a very simple outline for you. I simply want you to see three themes that we can expect to be a part of what we're calling the normal Christian life. Let me give these themes to you in advance. We want to see together, first, the context of the Christian life. Then we will spend some time looking at the cry of the Christian life. And then finally, we will look at the commitments of the Christian life. Let me remind you, we're limiting our discussion of these three themes to the eight verses that we're unpacking together in Psalm chapter 119. So first, notice the context of the Christian life. Have you ever heard someone say something that shocked you, and someone came along as you were about ready to lambast them, and they said, "Well, careful, there's a context to what they said." A context is all important, and it's also important in this particular section of Scripture. There are three things that I see emerging as important to the context of this passage and our Christian journeys. Number one, pain. Pain. Look at verse 153. The psalmist prays this prayer to God. He says, "Look on my" what? On my affliction. My affliction. That comes from a Hebrew word that could be readily translated as suffering or distress. God, look upon my suffering that I'm experiencing. God, look upon my distress. And this is a word that is found all throughout the Old Testament and is generally associated with great sorrow, sadness, or pain. One of the most poignant examples of pain is found, of course, in the story of Job. In Job chapter 30, verse 16, he says this, "And now my soul is poured out within me. Days of affliction have taken hold of me." If anyone understood pain, it was, of course, Job. But more than that, each of us, I think, can understand what it is to live lives that are filled with pain. He says in Job 30:27, my inward parts are in turmoil and never still. Days of affliction come to meet me. Later in Job, he says, if they are bound in chains and caught in the cords of affliction. Now think with me about this concept, affliction. By the way, it's more than a concept. It's reality. Some of you over the last several years have experienced a myriad of different kinds of painful events. First, there is physical affliction. Some of you are thinking to yourself, amen, Pastor, physical affliction. That's what I have been experiencing for months or many years. Physical affliction, of course, attacks the body in the form of pain or disease or both. Emotional affliction comes in many forms. It comes in the forms of things like fear and depression and anxiety and, as I've put it, a host of other mental monsters. How many of you can relate to these mental monsters? Fear, anxiety, those things that just wrap their arms around you, and sometimes it feels like they're going to squeeze the very life out of you. Then, of course, there's spiritual affliction, and I characterize spiritual affliction by internal spiritual affliction and external spiritual affliction. Externally, it looks like this. We may experience personal attack, either in person for our theological convictions, or, this is my favorite, in pen. That's shorthand for someone blogs about you. And they say things about your character and your convictions that you cling to as a follower of Jesus Christ. Then there's internal sorrow or internal suffering or pain, and that may involve things like unresolved guilt or shame for sins that you have committed in the past that you have not fully taken to the cross to allow Jesus to forgive you. As I think about these various forms of pain, physical pain, emotional pain, spiritual pain, this might surprise you. But as I brainstormed this, and it literally popped in my head, the very first person I thought of in church history when I considered physical pain, emotional pain, spiritual pain, was my hero, Charles Haddon Spurgeon. Because this is the man, some of you know this, we call him today the Prince of Preachers. Most would argue, and I would be among those who would argue, that Charles Haddon Spurgeon was by far the most powerful and influential English preachers to ever walk the planet. He was an absolutely incredible man. Yet Charles Haddon Spurgeon was an afflicted man. This is brand new information for a lot of people. As I've, over the years, I've shared with people all the different things that Spurgeon endured as a man of God. He says this in his autobiography. By the way, if you like to read biographies, and especially autobiographies, Charles Haddon Spurgeon's biography will rock your world. It's a two-volume biography, and I'll never forget when I read it. I found myself oftentimes in tears reading the words of this godly man. Here's one thing he notes that has to do with physical affliction. He says, quote, we have received many prescriptions for my gout, both for inward and outward application, and should have been dead long ago if we had tried half of them. Charles Haddon Spurgeon was a man who was afflicted with gout and other physical, painful maladies in his body. Then he also was a man who experienced emotional affliction. He said this, quote, I am the subject of depressions of spirit so fearful that I hope none of you ever get to such extremes of wretchedness as I go. It's a little known fact about Mr. Spurgeon that he became so melancholy and so depressed. And remember where he lives, by the way. It's a little bit like Whatcom County. I mean, how often do you get a sunny day in London, England? I think he's the one that named the clothing company, London Fog, right? It affected him in a deep way. But the little known fact is he became so depressed that he would literally vacation by himself in a port city in France where the sun was known to shine more often. And he would go there and he would dry out. and the weather would literally help him, and it would help him also spiritually. He said, spiritual sorrows are the worst of mental miseries. There's a book written by Pastor Zach S. Swine entitled Spurgeon's Sorrows. I commend it to you. It's a little book. You can probably read it in one or two sittings. I remember several years ago, I ordered a case of these. It impacted me in such a powerful way, and I gave these books out like candy. Do yourself a favor and pick up a copy of Spurgeon's Sorrows. But then he was also afflicted spiritually, referring to the text in Isaiah chapter 48:10 that says, I have chosen thee for the furnace of affliction. He writes this in his autobiography. This has long been the motto fixed before our eye upon the wall of our bedchamber, and in many ways it has also been written on our heart. It is no mean thing to be chosen of God. God's choice makes chosen men choice men. We are chosen not in the palace, but in the furnace. In the furnace, beauty is marred, fashion is destroyed, strength is melted, glory is consumed. Yet here, eternal love reveals its secrets and declares its choice. So this has been our case. Therefore, if today the furnace be heated 7 times hotter, we will not dread it. For the glorious Son of God will walk with us amid the glowing coals. Spurgeon went on to say, I have learned to kiss the wave that throws me against the rock of ages. When we think about the context of the Christian life that the psalmist refers to, we need to understand that the first thing is pain that he focuses on. But then there's a second thing. It might surprise you. He also focuses on, and the word is not in the text, but it's what I like to refer to as paganism. There's pain as part of the context of the Christian journey. Then there is paganism. And paganism in these 8 verses can be rightly summarized with 2 important words. Number one, wicked. Look at verse 155. He says, salvation is far from the wicked, for they do not seek your statutes. A wicked person is simply an ungodly person. This is a person who abandons the living God, who abandons the word of God. In Psalm chapter 10, verse 13, we read, why does the wicked renounce God and say in his heart, you will not call to count? We all know Psalm chapter 1. Some of us know it by heart, where the psalmist says, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits on the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in what? The law of the Lord. And on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. In all that he does, he prospers. Notice, the wicked are not so, but are like the chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. Fast forward to the pages of the New Testament, where Paul the Apostle understood his times and wrote in 2 Timothy chapter 3, we must understand this, that in the last days there will come times of difficulty. There will be people who are self-lovers, lovers of money, proud, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to parents, ungrateful, unholy, heartless, unappeasable, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not loving good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having the appearance of godliness, but denying its power. Very simply put, the wicked, as this verse indicates, verse 155, they do not seek God's statutes. The wicked literally spurn the law of God. Let me say it in a way that young people can relate to. The wicked hate God's guts. They literally despise God. Jonathan Edwards once said that if sinful man could kill God, he would. That's how much sinners hate God. That's why we should always be careful to never say something like this: I've always loved God. You know, there's not one person that's ever lived that can say, I've always loved God. Why? Because we are all born in a Pelagian state. We are all born hating God from the womb. In sin, my mother conceived me, King David said. So there's this word wicked that describes paganism, but then in verse 158, there's another word that describes it. It's the word faithless. And I have to be honest, I actually really like this verse, and I hope you do too. The psalmist says, I look at the faithless with disgust. Am I the only one that likes that verse? Have you ever felt that way? You look around you and you look at this ungodly world that we live in, and it's almost as if the psalmist gives us permission in this glimpse of this psalm. I am disgusted with the faithlessness that I see. The word faithless comes from a Hebrew word that means to act treacherously. This is an act of betrayal. And the faithless one, as this verse indicates, again, does not keep God's commandments. At the bottom of your notes, if you would add a third aspect of this point, that is persecution. Look at verse 157. The psalmist says, many are my persecutors and my adversaries, but I do not swerve from your testimonies. This really makes the point well that Paul makes in 1 Timothy chapter 3 when he says that all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Notice he doesn't say may be persecuted. He says if you are a follower of Jesus Christ, you will be persecuted. It's part of the context. This is the context of the Christian life that the psalmist describes for us, a life that is characterized by pain, one that endures the sting of paganism, and is also affected by persecution. Think for a moment about your context. Thousands of years after this text is penned, nothing has changed. Amen? Like, we endure pain. We endure these various things that the psalmist struggles with. We endure paganism. We endure persecution. Many of you, as I mentioned a moment ago, have experienced pain, whether it's physical, emotional, spiritual, or everything wrapped up together in one. Of course, each one of you has experienced the steady drip of paganism that pervades our culture, and maybe it's just me, but it seems, from my perspective, like it's getting worse every day. Are you experiencing that? That the pagan influences on our culture gets worse every day because our culture is not tuned in to the kingdom of God and his priorities. We live in a world that is devoted to three things: me, myself, and I. That's what our world is devoted to. There's a poem that's called Invictus by William Ernest Henley. And every time I read it, it gives me the shivers because it really describes the essence of paganism that I'm trying to drive home. Listen to this poem. It says, out of the night that covers me, black as the pit from pole to pole, I thank whatever gods may be for my unconquerable soul. In the fell clutch of circumstance, I have not winced nor cried aloud. Under the bludgeonings of chance, my head is bloody but unbowed. Behold, this place of wrath and tears looms but the horror of the shade, and yet the menace of the years finds and shall find me unafraid. It matters not how straight the gate, how charged with punishments the scroll. I am the master of my fate. I am the captain of my soul. I hope if you're a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, you see the wickedness that emerges in every line of that poem. Perhaps you're here this morning and you have endured the sting of persecution, persecution for your values, persecution for your Christian convictions. I can tell you that from time to time, I will write a book review. Most of my book reviews are very positive. I commend books. 90% of the book reviews I've done over the years are positive. But every once in a while, I'll find an author who professes to be a Christian who writes like a pagan. And that's the kind of book review that I take, like my dog gets a hold of the bone and just chews it to shreds, right? And so that's how the book reviews come out. Well, guess what? I get feedback about those book reviews, and they're not pretty, and there are cuss words, and there is anger, and there is vitriol, and it's all directed at little old yours truly. And I'm labeled as a conservative, I'm labeled as a Pharisee, I'm labeled as a zealot, I'm labeled as an ignoramus, whatever it is, but we're persecuted for the stances that we take in the Christian life. Pain, paganism, persecution. This is the context that the psalmist speaks of in this unit of thought. Notice secondly, and briefly, the cry of the Christian life. And the cry of the psalmist that he utters in this section of Scripture is a simple threefold request. First, I want you to see a cry for deliverance. Now, if you think about pain, paganism, and persecution, it makes complete sense that the psalmist would cry out, Lord, save me. So verse 153, he says, look at my affliction and deliver me, for I do not forget your law. That word deliver means to save from destruction, to save from harm. In Psalm chapter 6, verse 4, the psalmist writes, turn, O Lord, deliver my life, save me for the sake of your steadfast love. There's not only a cry for deliverance, there's also a cry for redemption. Drop down to verse 154. He says, plead my cause and redeem me. Give me life according to your promise. And then, of course, there's a cry for life. And this is intriguing to me because it emerges all throughout this section of Scripture. Verse 154, plead my cause and redeem me. Give me life according to your promise. Verse 156, great is your mercy, O Lord. Give me life according to your rules. Verse 159, consider how I love your precepts. You see it? Give me life according to your steadfast love. Let me slow down just for a minute. You're like, thank you. The New American Standard Version gives what I believe is great insight into these three verses that I just read, as the Hebrew word is translated as not give me life, which I see in my English Standard Version, which is a perfectly legitimate translation, but the New American Standard translates this Hebrew word as revive. When the psalmist is crying out for life, he's really crying out for revival. And it's at this moment, I believe, that we really get into the sandals of the psalmist. As he is in the midst of pain and paganism and persecution, and in this context, he's asking God, bring revival. Bring personal revival, bring corporate revival amongst your people. We need revival. Now, if you're like many people in the West, when you think of revival, something pops into your head. And we don't have the time to go person by person and interview all of you, but my suspicion is there are opinions all around the room this morning as to what revival is. And my suspicion would be that most of what we consider to be revival is not true revival. Martin Lloyd-Jones, and I like to kind of tell you what's coming down the pike. Some of you like that. Some of you like to be surprised. If you want to be surprised, just put your fingers in your ears. But those of you that like to know what's coming, on Reformation Sunday, which will be the last Sunday in October, most of you know we do either a doctrinal theme from the Protestant Reformation or a biographical sketch of an influential Christian. In about 3 weeks, I will begin preparing for that message. So June, July, August, September, October, 5 months. So if you can just remember this day, when we get to the Reformation Sunday message, some of you are thinking, you study 5 months, Pastor, that better be a good message, right? Because we will be exploring the life, legacy, and the ministry of the doctor, Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones. Here's what Lloyd-Jones says about revival, and it's powerful. He really cuts through all the fog of uncertainty. He says, true emotion produced by the Holy Spirit always leads to humility, to reverence, to a holy love of God. A man may sing or may dance for a while, but that does not persist. He says it is temporary and due to the weakness of the body, but what is permanent and what proves genuineness is that the man is filled with a sense of awe. And then he concludes, he has been near the majesty of God and is of necessity humbled. This is revival. Revival is not pandemonium. Revival is not charismatic excess. I believe Martin Lloyd-Jones has his finger on the essence of revival, and this is what the psalmist is crying out for. God, revive me. Revive the people of God. We've seen the context of the Christian life. We've seen the cry of the Christian life. And finally, I want you to see with me what we're calling the commitments of the Christian life. And what I've decided to do is look at four commitments, and I've put these in the first person. This is not how it emerges in this text, but I believe we get to the heart and the soul of what the psalmist wants you and I to be committed to. The first commitment of the psalmist is this: I put the word of God at the forefront of my mind. Or, I put the word of God first. Verse 153. We've seen this several times. Look on my affliction and deliver me. And here's the point I want you to see. For I do not forget your law. That word forget means to dismiss from the mind. And so the psalmist's commitment is very clear. He resolves in his mind to always hold true, to always be faithful to the word of God. And here is the implication. It's more than merely the word of God. The implication is he commits to never forget who God is. You remember that famous Tozer quote? What we think about God is the most important thing about us. The psalmist says this: I will learn about God, I will meditate upon God, I will cast my attention on what the Word of God says God is, not what I want Him to be like. You see, this is what so many authors like William Young have done, like Rob Bell have done, like Tony Jones have done. They have said, we don't like the God of the Bible. This is what we think God is like. The psalmist says, I will have none of that. I will be faithful to who God is. I will be faithful to what his character is like. I will believe what his law prescribes, what his law demands, and what his promises entail. To put it more memorably and positively, the psalmist, you can say, makes this commitment. I will never forget doctrine. I will never forget God's demands. And I will be devoted in a way that God is glorified. Psalm chapter 119, verse 15 and 16, all the way back to the beginning of our study. The psalm writer says, I will meditate on your precepts and fix my eyes on your ways. I will delight in your statutes. I will not forget your word. That is to say, I will always put the word of God first. Second commitment, look at verse 157. He says, many are my persecutors and my adversaries. We saw that. Here's his commitment. I do not swerve from your testimonies. That is to say, I never deviate from the word of God. It's interesting because that word swerve in the Hebrew actually means to deviate or to turn from. And the psalmist says, I will never do that. You recall how the Apostle Paul, if we fast forward to the New Testament, how he laments how his friends, Hymenaeus and Alexander, swerved away from the gospel, how they swerved from the truth of God's word. 1 Timothy 1:19 and 20 says this, "By rejecting this, some have made shipwreck of their faith, among whom are Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I have handed over to Satan, that they may not learn to blaspheme." I should tell you that this has been a rather difficult week for me, because I have a friend who I have served with and loved for over 20 years. He is a man who has been a pastor for most of his adult life. And as I began to have concerns and questions, I put a phone call into someone who has an impact and influence in his ministry. And within 3 weeks, a letter was composed after that phone call. A letter was composed asking that man to step down from the ministry he's serving. And why? Because my friend is deviating from the gospel. And so that has been the focus of my prayers for the last several days, that my friend would realize that he has to hold true to the gospel, that he can never deviate from the word of the living God. The psalmist, you see, never does this. He resolves to never walk down this kind of path. I believe that he would have resonated and benefited from the Apostle Paul's message to the young pastor Timothy in the book of 1 Timothy when he said, "Keep a close watch on your life and your teaching. Persist in this, for by doing so, you will save both yourself and your hearers." He said later in chapter 6, "But as for you, O man of God," speaking to Timothy, "flee these things. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, steadfastness, gentleness. Fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of the eternal life with which you were called and about which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses." The psalmist put the word of God at the forefront of his mind. He made a commitment to never deviate from the truth of God's word, but he's not finished. He makes a third commitment, and it can be stated as follows: I love the word. I'm just curious, how many of you this morning can say, "I love the word"? Two, three. Wait a minute. Dude, okay. We're so expressive, aren't we? Hold on just a minute. I'm going to close my eyes, take a time out. Okay, how many of you love the word? Okay, much better. Wow, what happened there? We want to stand with the psalmist by affirming that we love the word. Verse 159, he says, "Consider how I love your precepts." It is the same author who said in verse 11 of Psalm 119, "I have stored your word in my heart that I might not sin against you." It is the same author who said in verse 24, "Your testimonies are my delight. They are my counselors." Not Oprah, not Dr. Phil, not Tucker Carlson, not Sean Hannity, not Donald Trump, not Joseph Biden. The word of God. That's where I get my advice. That's where I get my counsel. Verse 113, the same psalmist says, "I hate the double-minded, but I love your law." And I love the final commitment that we see here. It emerges in verse 160. And if I can be really honest with you, last week as we were worshiping, I was looking ahead to the text that I would preach this week, and I couldn't stop looking at verse 160. This says, "The sum of your word is truth." Francis Schaeffer used to say, "True truth." I love that. Is there any other kind of truth? Answer, no. And he says, "Every one of your righteous rules endures forever." Now, notice here that the psalmist's progression of thought is both biblical and logical. Let me explain. He affirms that God's word is true comprehensively. Why? The sum of your words is truth. If we could bump ahead to the fourth point, that'd be fantastic. He says this: the Bible is God-breathed. The Bible is infallible. The Bible is inerrant in the original autographs. The Bible is clear for students of theology, perspicuity, right? The Bible is our highest authority. Last week I quoted Schaeffer, who said, holding to a strong view of Scripture or not holding to it is the watershed of the evangelical world. You know what Schaeffer was doing with that quote? He is saying there's two kinds of Christians. He's saying there are the Christians who are going to man up and say, the Word of God is my highest authority. Then there's this other group of people that says, you know, I like the Word of God, but. And I'm curious, which group do you land in today? Are you the group that says, the Word of God's my highest authority, like my friend Josh said a week ago? Or are you the people that say, yeah, I like the Word, but I also like Sigmund Freud? People do this. It's called the two-book approach to the Christian faith. Or, I like the Bible, but I also draw insight from Carl Jung, the occultic writer. Or, I like the Word of God, but I draw on all these other sources. He affirms the Word of God is true truth. It is true comprehensively, but he also affirms the timelessness of God's Word. He says, every one of your righteous rules endures forever. That is to say, the Word of God does not shift with time. The Word of God, listen, is, according to Hebrews 4:12, is living and active, but it is not, constitutional scholars, a living document. You know what I mean by that? Those on the left say that the Constitution is a living document. That is, it morphs over time. And that's what people do with the Bible. They say, oh, that was a matter of cultural priority. Paul didn't allow women to occupy the office of an elder because that was culturally driven. That was not culturally driven. That was God-driven. And so while the Word of God is living and active, it is not a living document that changes with the times. The Word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the divisions of the soul and spirit, of the joints and marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. You have to love Jeremiah 23 that says, is not my word like fire, declares the Lord, and like a hammer that breaks the rock in pieces? Let me see if I can wrap all this up. The normal Christian life always has a context, and the psalmist here helps us discover that we, as a matter of fact, must endure pain and paganism and persecution. We can't escape it. We can't escape it. And the normal Christian life also involves a cry, and he models for us what it looks like to cry to God for deliverance, to cry for redemption, to ask God for personal revival. And then finally, the normal Christian life involves commitments, and each of these four commitments that we've focused on centers on the truthfulness of God's holy word. My challenge for you today is this. Are you ready to stand with the writer of Psalm 119 and commit your life to God and the Word of God? Let me make it more specific and convicting. Are you ready to say with the psalmist, I put the Word of God first? Are you prepared to say with the psalmist, I will never deviate from the Word of God? Can you say with the psalmist and say without flinching, I love the Word? And are you ready to draw a final line in the sand and live according to the creed that says, it is the Word of God that governs my life? You see, what struck me as I was studying this passage is that the normal Christian life is not peaches and cream. Amen? It's just not peaches and cream. The normal Christian life bears no resemblance, as I mentioned earlier, to the so-called prosperity gospel. The normal Christian life, if I can be rather crude, is messy. It is filled with ups and downs, and it is best portrayed in one of the greatest books ever penned by a man, The Pilgrim's Progress. Surprise, surprise. A life where the protagonist by the name of Christian is faced with suffering and temptation and disappointment and bitter providence. But at the center of the Christian life and at the center of this story is the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ that redeems us from our sin. Jesus invites every one of us to come to the cross, to lay down our burdens. It's the gospel that tells us that our sins will be forgiven. Not 20% of our sins, not 90% of our sins, but 100% of our sins will be forgiven if we repent and trust in Christ's death, burial, resurrection that occurred on the third day. Three passages that bear witness to this. Psalm chapter 103, as far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. Jeremiah chapter 31, 34, for I will forgive their iniquity, I will remember their sin no more. Micah 7, 19, he will again have compassion on us. He will dread our iniquities underfoot. You will cast all of our sins into the depths of the sea. This is what happens at the cross of Jesus Christ. And as I was preparing for this message, I received one of these emails that I keep in the flyleaf of my Bible from one of my students at Ecola Bible College from just a few weeks ago. It came at just the right time for me, and I trust it will come at the right time for you as well. My student writes, "Hi, Dr. Steele. I wanted to tell you that I finished The Pilgrim's Progress and that it was my first time ever reading it. Your class was such an amazing class, and I loved it so much. Pilgrim's Progress made me think about my past burden that I had not given up to God. I struggled all spring term with guilt and feelings of shame for the things that I have done. Reading The Pilgrim's Progress really helped me to understand that I am loved and valuable in the eyes of God." Now, here is a young person who has come to terms with the cross of Jesus Christ. She has acknowledged the context. She cried out to God. And now she is making commitments to move forward in her walk with God and her pilgrimage to the celestial city. Some of you might wonder, how would I respond to an email like that? I'll read you in part. "I commended her for taking her sin to the cross and rejoicing in the wonderful, undeserved grace of God. And I left her with a quote by Jerry Bridges to encourage her on her Christian journey. And while I did not tell her this, I hope and I pray, and I hope that you will do this as well, that she printed this quote out and she either put it on her dresser or put it in the flyleaf of her Bible or put it on the dash of her car or put it on her refrigerator, someplace where she can see it and delight in this great truth." And here's what Bridges says: "Your worst days are never so bad that you are beyond the reach of God's grace. And your best days are never so good that you are beyond the need for God's grace." I'm curious, where do you stand today? Christians, do you find yourself daily at the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ, where you receive forgiveness freely, all because of what Christ accomplished on the cross of Christ? You know, yesterday, the Olsen family gathered to say goodbye to Rose Olsen. And it was a wonderful service as we gathered together. And after I listened to all the testimonies and all the tributes and the message, here's what I walked away with that struck me the most. Rose Olsen was a woman who stood in the shadow of the cross of Jesus Christ. So on Mother's Day, I want to challenge all the mothers to follow in the footsteps of Rose Olsen. Nothing would make Rose happier than to hear that the women, the mothers at Christ Fellowship, decided to follow her lead, to follow her example by standing in the shadow of the cross of Christ. This morning, if you're not yet a Christian, my challenge is very simple. Today is the day of salvation. do I urge you to repent of your sin and to trust in Jesus' life, death, burial, resurrection, his ascension, to remember that he's seated at the right hand of God, and now he prays for all of his people. There's never a second of any day when he's not praying at the right hand of the Father for his people. The time to trust Christ is now. And for the rest of us, it's time to commence in the normal Christian life. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your word, and we thank you for all that we have discovered in Psalm chapter 119. Lord, help us today to remember the context that the psalmist refers to of pain and paganism and persecution. Help us to remember his cry to you, God, and may we draw some important lessons from that, Lord, to be transparent before you, to cry for deliverance, to cry for redemption, to cry for personal and corporate revival. And Father, we think of these four commitments that the psalmist makes. I pray that each one of these commitments would find lodging in our hearts. Lord, that we would be serious about your word, that we would be a word-centered people, which means that by definition, we are a gospel-centered people. Lord, I pray for anyone here that is exploring the claims of the Christian faith, that you would draw someone to yourself, that they would see the work of the Lord Jesus Christ, that they would see the person of the Lord Jesus Christ and acknowledge all that he accomplished for the people of God on Calvary's cross, and there would be true repentance and true saving faith, and that you would indeed be glorified. Now, Lord, thank you again for all that you are to us. Thank you for the hope that we have in the gospel. Thank you for the joy that we can experience each day. And we acknowledge that the Christian journey is a life of ups and downs, but all along the way, Jesus, you are our steady anchor. You are our rock of fortress. Indeed, a mighty fortress is our God. In Jesus' name, amen. Pray together. Father, thank you so much for our time together today. God, I pray that you would give us strength to live the Christian life, the normal Christian life. Lord, I pray that we would remember the insight from the Word of God today that will propel us into the future by your grace and for your glory. And all God's people said, amen. Have a wonderful day.